very lucky to be up here today in Caernarfon at the search and rescue base here. We've got two Sikorskis behind me, this one here and this one behind me. We're gonna take a little bit of a tour, have a bit of a look around, and we're with the chief pilot today, an amazing guy and a highly accomplished pilot, Dave, who's been flying his whole life. So he's gonna give us a little bit of a tour and we're gonna have a look round. These aircraft are just incredible. So let's go and have a look. Sikorsky here. Dave is going to give us a tour from the back to the front, and let's go.
Okay, so first thing you see at the back, well, you'll see lots of it actually, but medical stuff.
So this hatch obviously comes down.
Yeah, this one comes down and that one goes up, which is great, because behind you is where we put the stretchers.
Yeah.
So in certain scenarios, we can bring the stretcher straight through.
Ah, perfect, yeah.
Straight away. And it's set up as a little medical station. Mm. You know, the stuff is all around it. Stuff we keep in here is stuff we don't need as often.
Yeah.
Everything is designed that if you want it urgently, it's close to where you want it. You know, so you keep stuff near where you need it. So this stuff isn't the things that we use immediately and every day. It's pretty much out of the way. But it is a great feature, that ramp.
Yeah.
As we come forward, this is kind of more the working area. The blue stuff you see on the floor is because we don't know where we're going, you know, we could be picking somebody up out of the water, and when they come up, they're soaking wet.
Yeah.
What we don't want is seawater soaking into the air.
Absolutely, yeah.
So this wet fit floor is designed to contain the water.
Yeah, that makes total sense.
And then at the end of the job, it kind of gets swabbed out.
It's considerably bigger than I thought. It's huge in here, isn't it?
When the engineers sort of strip all this stuff out, you see how big it is then. Yeah. It's just a big box. You know, and then we fill it. There isn't the will or the money to design a bespoke SAR aircraft anymore.
Yeah.
You know, there just isn't that role. So these, the design was initially oil and gas. You know, in an oil and gas bit, these are full of seats. This aircraft was brand new for search and rescue, and it's never flown oil and gas or transport. But you can see the sort of heritage of the design with these gaspers for the passengers.
Yeah.
And all the windows. My background's Air Force. A lot of the guys are Navy. We've got some civilians all the way through. What you can see is that in the next generation of helicopters, how much more safety focused they are. So every window is a fire exit.
Wow, you know, so that will just push out.
Just pushes out. And then we've also got bigger exits here, the main door, and two for the pilot and one for the winch operator. The idea being, if you do end up ditching, you can take anything.
Now, talking about ditching, am I right that this aircraft will float?
Should do.
Yeah.
We're flotation banks, basically.
Yeah.
So they inflate once we're on the water. They'll keep us on top of the water for hours. They might not keep us upright.
Yeah.
We might be upside down, because if you think, a lot of the weight's up
It's there. All at the top, yeah, the gearbox and the engine. Yeah.
Engines, yeah. And the stuff below is fairly light. So in a rough sea state, it'll probably turn upside down, but we've got a chance of getting out, because all of these will light automatically on their internal batteries. So you know where you're going. Moving forward then, medical stuff. So I say the stretcher often goes on here. You know, the casualty is there.
How many casualties can you cater for? It looks like we've got one stretcher here.
Yeah, you could do as many as you want, but bearing in mind there's only two guys in the back, so they'd have to divide their time. Often what happens, if it's a serious casualty and you know they need action straight away, they'll probably do it on the floor.
Okay.
It takes time to get them up here, whereas a lot of the stuff is done at the front. You know? It's not that often that we need somebody in a stretcher. You know, if it's a broken ankle, probably not on a stretcher, they might put them in a seat or on the floor. And we've got, which isn't normally on, this is, I was talking about the floor.
Yeah.
Waterproof. When we're in the winter and you pick people up with crampons on, we don't want them walking on that. So we've got an extra floor that we carry in the winter, which lays on the front portion.
That's a really good idea. I never thought about that.
So it's extra weight we'd rather not carry in the summer, so it only comes on in the winter.
Yeah.
And the boys carry avalanche transceivers and, you know, winter stuff that they use.
And do you have a countdown on the... So you will know to the minute how much fuel you've got left.
No, we can see the burn rate, and we can see how much fuel we've got, and then you can do the maths.
Oh, you have to do the maths, okay.
Yeah, because the burn rate changes with your speed.
Yeah, and your engine RPM, your power you're putting through, yeah.
It's a weird thing, a helicopter generally takes more power to hover than it does in forward.
Oh, yeah, absolutely,
so,
yeah.
You know, it does change, but we have got a gauge that indicates that.
So medically, I mean, it looks like this is a small operating sort of theatre. I mean, you've got a lot of kit here.
Yeah, it's kind of not that level, but the winch man, the guy who goes down on the wire, they're all paramedics.
Yeah.
So exactly the same as the guys on the road. So they do a lot of medical stuff, which I'm blissfully unaware of most of the time. We sit up front
and
look around, because, you know, if you're not good with blood, it's not the thing you want to see. So they are seriously qualified.
Sorry,
station box for intercom and radios. Yep. So this is the winchman paramedic seat, which is generally where he sits. And then when we get onto the job, he changes mode. But he's not a passenger. You know, until we get to the job, he's part of the crew.
Yeah.
Working the radios, he might be navigating, he's certainly helping Duncan on the weather. But he's also making a load of radio calls.
Yeah.
Up front, we're generally monitoring 2 VHF, maybe a UHF, probably 1 FM, maybe 2 FM, HF. Airwave, tetra, there's a lot to monitor. And we can't do it up front. You know, if we're going through a busy bit of airspace, we'll need these guys to... Our controllers are down at Fairham. We can't generally monitor that up front if we're going through a busy bit of airspace. So these guys are working that radio. So busy guys, talented guys. They do it well, they really do. So whilst it looks like he's just sitting there, you know, and he's a passenger, he's not a member of the crew.
Fantastic.
Similar with this guy. So. Winchman, winch operator.
Yeah.
So the guy who does the winching with this guy on the end of it.
Yep.
A lot of this is turned off at the moment, but he also operates the mission systems. So we've got a kind of a very high powered camera on the side.
Yeah.
Which is a television camera, but it's also an infrared camera, which we use fairly often. Certainly use it at night and often during the day, you know, when the conditions suit for a search. But it also gives us, you know, a heads up. We can be arriving on scene and then we can see what's going on from a couple of miles away.
Yeah.
Once we've got first response bag, this is what the winchman will take down with him onto the ground. So as we spot the casualty and winch the winchman out to him, we'll take that with him. So he's got most of the stuff he'll need immediately. We might then ask for more medical stuff, which is why the winch operator is also medically trained, so he knows.
Yeah.
He can anticipate what he might need, but he also has an idea of, you know, what's coming up next.
That's funny.
It kind of looks a lot at first, but if you simplify it, there's a lot of redundancy.
Yeah.
You know, we've got 4 screens, which you can repeat on any one you want. You know, they all swap across, so if that one fails, we can move it here. So you can straight away simplify things that there aren't that many that you've got to look at. And it's much like any aircraft, really. It's designed that the stuff you need straight away is close to where you are. So this one we call the PFD, primary flight display, that's how the aircraft's behaving. Most of the controls we need straight away or quickly, you know, are by your hands.
Yeah.
And, you know, whilst it looks a lot of buttons, it isn't really, because your thumb can only reach 2 of them, you know, you think you can only reach another couple. So if you can remember, it's my thumb.
This must be some kind of trim.
Which one are you on? Yeah, hoist. Oh, yeah. I didn't say, actually. There are occasions when they winch the casualties in and the boys are busy with their hands. So the control I showed you for the hoist, you can't reach it. Yeah. So we then have a control of the hoist.
Okay.
So that's winch in and winch out. If things go wrong as well, we've also got a hoist shear, a cable cut. So if he calls us to cut the cable, we press that. An electric squib fires and the cable gets cut.
Yeah.
We test it every day to make sure it works, but you're always hoping never to have to use it.
No,
it's not stuff you really want to be touching if you can help it, you know.
That's your horizon.
Yeah, and that moves around.
Yeah.
You know, that's
yeah, I had a horizon. I've got a horizon on my Garmin.
It's great, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's half help.
Yeah.
Especially if you're in the mountains where you don't have a horizon.
Yeah.
You know, yes, it's critical, really. Airspeed, we've got little bugs we can move around with. So today, that bug is at 42, which was kind of our VTOS, takeoff safety speed, effectively.
Yeah.
Which means that, I was saying earlier, a helicopter takes more power to hover than it does forward flight.
Yeah.
It means if we can get to 42 knots, we can probably fly on one engine.
Yeah.
So we call that our VTOS, and then there are all the speeds above that. To the side then, altimeter, we've got an ALP and a MIN. ALP is what we program the autopilot to do. So if we press the button, it would take us up to 4,600 feet. That that's local to here, based on Snowdon. Snowdon's about 3.6, so it gives us 1,000 on top of Snowdon. Being in, if we hit cloud and inadvertently we press the button, it takes us up above Snowdon. Down below compass, effectively.
Yeah.
We call it an HSI with lots of bugs, and then we have a backup here as the manual system. And down the side, this is, obviously they're not working at the moment, but that tells you how fast the engines are going round and how fast the rotors are going round.
Yeah.
Generally, they're...
What's your rotor speed? 300? 350?
I don't know, actually, it's 100%.
What that is, I think it's 203.
So here we are looking at these incredible bits of kit, and I have top man Dave behind me. So we're going to ask Dave a few questions. So how long have you been flying, Dave?
I started when I was 17, so
4 years
now.
4 years? Yeah. Wow.
I was very lucky. I got sponsored by the Air Force, did a flying scholarship
when
I was 17, so that was learning to fly, and sponsored through university, joined the Air Force. 16 and a half years in the Air Force, and now civilian search and rescue.
And what did you fly in the Air Force?
Mostly Sea Kings.
Yeah.
So mostly helicopters, mostly search and rescue, and then a bit of instruction as well.
Fantastic. Yeah. And so, sorry, how long have you been doing search and rescue for now?
Since 1996.
So you've been doing this a while now.
Yeah, you'd think I'd be better, wouldn't you?
No, you are.
Yeah, it goes quickly though,
fantastic.
It seems like yesterday. We've been here as Bristow Search and Rescue for the Coast Guard since 2015.
Yeah.
So 4.5 years now.
Yeah.
Kind of taking over from Valley, which is 9 miles down the road.
Yeah. What would you say is probably the most enjoyable, most rewarding part of this job?
I think most of the guys, and I do as well, you enjoy going on a rescue. I know it's probably the weird thing to say, but it's... There's a sense of satisfaction.
Yeah.
You've helped and you've done a little bit for the day. And if we're not going on a job or training, so it's
fantastic.
It's a good bunch to work with as well.
Yeah.
Mostly.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Fantastic. So do you have any advice for any young person who has dreams and aspirations to become a helicopter pilot? What advice would you have?
Follow them.
Yeah.
You know, give it a go.
Yeah.
I didn't know I'd have made it. I didn't really know what I wanted to do. Gave it a go. I've never looked
and
back.
And here you are.
Almost every moment of it. Yeah.
Fantastic.
And if you can get somebody else to pay for it, so much the better.
So brilliant.
If you can join the Air Force or the Navy, I'd advise it.
Yeah.
Great. Had a great time. And it's set me up well for the future.
Fantastic.
Yeah.